We are going to start. So last week, we started our study of reflection positivity. Let me just remind you the main definition. So we are working on the discrete torus, t-dimensional discrete torus, which was just the D. We are considering some set of configuration omega L defined on the torus, which were just given by associating to each vertex of the torus some element of some topological space S. Okay. And then we are considering some measure on this set of configuration with the product sigma algebra. And then we are saying that, okay, given a reflection theta, of the torus, we said that mu was reflection positive with respect to this reflection theta, if and only if the following two conditions were satisfied: the expected value under mu of f theta g was equal to the expectation of g theta f under mu, and f theta f was not negative, and this had to hold for all functions f and g, which were living in this algebra of function a plus of theta, which were all the functions which had their support in one half. So we have this reflection theta. Again, let me draw the picture in dimension one. So we have our torus here. This is t, 1, l. Then we have the reflection theta, which maps each of these two halves onto the other. And this half was denoted by t 1 L plus, this was t 1 L minus, and then this set was the set of all functions from omega L to R with support of H included in t L plus. Okay, so these were just some definitions we saw last week. And then we saw that if a measure is reflection positive with respect to some reflection theta, then this expectation here defines a scalar product to which is associated a Cauchy-Schwarz inequality. So we finished with that last week. And now I would like to turn to the second thing we'll need, which is to prove that such measure exists. Okay. So how do we construct the construction of reflection positive measures? And I will start with the most trivial example of a reflection positive measure, which is just the product measure. So that's lemma 10.5. So we give ourselves some measure rho on this set S, a set of a single spin state. So let rho be some measure on S. And let, say, mu naught be the product measure where I take a copy of rho at each vertex of the torus. Then this measure is reflection positive. Then it belongs to Rp of theta for all reflections theta of the torus. So it's a trivial case, but a trivial case on which we will construct more interesting measures. Okay. So this one, we have to distinguish. I mean, I'm saying that this works for any reflection theta of the torus. We saw that there are two types of reflections that are natural to study: reflections through edges and reflections through vertices. So through edges was when the the reflection plane went through the edges of the torus and through the vertices of the torus, and when it goes through the edges, it was reflection through edges. And let's start with the simplest case, which is theta is a reflection through edges of the torus. Then this is very easy because if you write f theta g, so you take f and g like here, which lives in the same half torus. Want to compute the expectation of this under mu naught. So the observation now that you have to make is that so f belongs to a plus of theta, g belongs to a plus of theta, but theta g belongs to a minus of theta. Okay, because theta is just sending the support of g on the other side of the torus. So that means that the support of f and of theta g, they are disjoint. Okay, and since this is a product measure, these two random variables are independent. So this is just f mu naught theta g mu naught. Okay. Here I'm using the fact that the support of f and g, okay, and theta g, are disjoint. Okay. So this factorizes, and then everything is finished because this quantity, of course, this is equal to expectation of g under mu naught, because it's clear that mu is invariant under reflection, because a reflection of the torus is just a relabeling of the vertices, and we are considering a product measure. Product measure is independent under relabeling of the vertices. Okay, so immediately we have the result we want, because the expression we obtain in the end is f, expectation of f times expectation of g, so this is symmetric in f and g, so of course the first condition is satisfied. And if you take f theta f, then you get the expectation of f square, which is non-negative. Okay, so clearly the two conditions are satisfied. So let's turn to reflections through vertices, where things are a bit more complicated, because for reflections through vertices, like here, there are some vertices which belong both to TL plus and TL minus, so it's not obvious that F and G have disjoint support. They might not have disjoint support, so we need a very slightly more complicated argument. It's almost the same. So theta reflection through vertices. Then let me denote by P the intersection of D L plus intersection TD L minus. So the set of vertices which belong to both halves. And then let me write FP, the sigma algebra, which is generated by the spins in P. Okay, I'm just looking at all the functions which only depends on what happens on this set of vertices. Okay. And then what we do is the simplest thing we can do to recover independence between F and theta G is to condition on what, so these are a priori not independent because the support of F and the support of theta G might contain some point of P. But what we can do is that we can condition what happens on P, and then they will become conditionally independent. So this is just, say, F theta G conditional on what happens on P, and take expectation. Okay, this is certainly okay. And then now conditionally on what happens on P, these two guys now, so they are conditionally independent. So I can repeat exactly the argument we had before. So this will be say mu zero f given fp, mu zero theta g given fp. And then for the same reason as before, because it's just a relabeling of product measure, this is the same as mu zero of G Fp. Okay. So again, we're done because if you take, okay, first, this is symmetric in F and G, so the first condition is satisfied. And if you take F and F, then you get something which is a square. Expectation of a positive random variable is positive. So this is all. Okay, that's a trivial. So the product measure is a trivial example of reflection positive measure. But from this one, in a very simple lemma, we can construct all kinds of interesting Gibbs measures. And that's what I want to explain now. So let me say what I mean by a Gibbs measure on the torus, but it's exactly the same thing we have seen in many different situations now during the semester. So Gibbs distributions on the torus, they are constructed as follows. So these will be measures which I will denote, say, mu L, probability measure on omega L, which is such that it's a probability measure. Okay, it's a probability measure on this set, such that the probability it associated to an event A is given up to a normalization constant by the integral over omega L E minus H L of omega indicator omega, and then the say product over E in T D L rho d omega, d omega I. So this is the partition function as usual. That's some Hamiltonian, defined as before. So where HL is the Hamiltonian. And rho is some a priori measure on S. Not necessarily normalized, doesn't matter. Measure on S. And then my point is that if you, there are whole classes of Hamiltonian H for which the measures which we define this in this way are automatically reflection positive. So if H was not there, when H is equal to zero, this is reflection positive because it's just a product measure. And we have just proven that this is reflection positive. Now if you add here a density which has a nice structure, then reflection positivity is preserved. And that's the content of lemma 10.6. So let's suppose that the Hamiltonian can be written as follows. So HL can be written as some function A plus the reflection of the function A plus a sum or some indices of function C alpha theta of C alpha. Okay. For some functions, A and C alpha, okay, for some functions A and C alpha, which all belongs to A plus of theta. Okay. Assume you have something like that. Then the corresponding measure mu L, constructed as here, then mu L is reflection positive with respect to theta. That's what we are going to check now. What we want to check, again, we have to look at F theta G under this measure mu L, okay, and check that the two conditions are the defined reflection positivity are satisfied. So what is this quantity? By definition, it's I can write it as 1 over ZL. And then I have the expectation of F theta G and E minus the Hamiltonian. So I'm not very happy with the signs. Let me write my define minus H as this form. So just changing the sign of A and the C alpha. This will be simpler. So E plus theta of E plus the sum over alpha of C alpha theta of C alpha. Okay. And this is the expectation under the measure, the product measure, which we called nu naught before. Okay, if I write this, I just have E minus H, the product measure, which is the reference measure we have in the definition there, and F theta G divided by the normalization is just this quantity. Okay, and then what we do is, so this part is okay, this is something which I can write, so let me do it here. So we are happy with the beginning because I have F, I have theta G, then I have EA and theta of EA. These are things which have a nice structure. I can put all the reflected parts together. But I have this this exponential of the sum over alpha of C alpha theta C alpha, which mixes function which lives on one side of the torus and function which lives on the other side of the torus, the reflection. Right? So this I'm not very happy with. So what I will do is that I will expand the exponential here. So let's expand the exponential. So we get sum over n equal to 0, 1 over n factorial, sum over alpha 1, alpha n, and then we get C alpha 1, C alpha n, theta of C alpha 1, theta of C alpha n. Okay? Let me see. Have just expanded this exponential of the sum of the C alpha theta C alpha. And now I can rewrite this in a slightly more readable way. So that's 1 over ZL, sum over n, 1 over n factorial, sum over alpha 1, alpha n. And then I have, what do I have? I have F, E to the A. Then I have C alpha 1, C alpha n. And then I have theta of G, E to the A, C alpha 1, C alpha n. And this is again the expectation under the product measure mu naught. Okay. And we're done. We're done because we know that this guy here, this is reflection positive. This belongs to Rp of theta, the product measure. That's what we proved in the previous lemma here, lemma 10.5. Okay. So we know that I have something of the form some function here times the reflection of some function. I can just move the reflection on the other side and does not change anything because this guy is reflection positive. So the first condition is satisfied. I can exchange F and G. And then the second condition, if you just take F and F, then you get a function here and a reflection of the same function there. Since mu zero is reflection positive, this quantity must be non-negative, and therefore this is F theta F is non-negative. That's the whole proof. There is nothing more to do. Okay. So this gives you a way of constructing many reflection positive measures on the torus. And let me give you an exercise where you can check that some specific Hamiltonian are reflection positive using this result, this lemma. So it's exercise 10.7. So check that. Any Gibbs measure on the torus with a Hamiltonian. Of the form. So let me write it like that. So H cell of omega, it has one part which is nearest neighbor, so I'm summing over all pairs ij in the torus, such that, say, the Euclidean distance between I and j is equal to 1, so that's the nearest neighbor. They have some function v1 of omega I omega j. Then I have a sum over all ij in the torus, which are second nearest neighbors, so the Euclidean distance is square root of 2, v2 of omega I omega j. And then maybe you have an additional term of this form, v3 omega I depends only on one spin. So if you take something like that, and if your function v1 and v2, they are invariant under interchange of their arguments, such that v1 of xy is v1 of yx, and v2 of xy is v2 of yx, then all these measures are necessarily reflection positive. That is, this Hamiltonian can be put in this form. Okay, that's what you can check. So check that any given lambda is or belongs to RP of theta for any theta. So we have a large class, and this is not the most general case. Probably an exercise you will do something much more general, but this already shows you that you have a very large class of reflection positive Gibbs measures on the torus, and so we are not we are studying some tool which has a rather broad range of applicability. Okay, so with that, I'm done with the basics on reflection positivity, and now we are going to turn to the first non-trivial estimate, non-trivial tool, which is the chessboard estimate. So again, this is something which can be done for reflections through edges and reflections through vertices. The proofs are essentially the same all the time. There are just tiny things to change. I will just treat the case of edges, and you can check that everything goes through for vertices in the same way. So. Discuss the case of reflection for edges. The extension is straightforward. There is really, you don't need any new idea to treat the case of reflections through vertices. Just to fix notations, I will work with reflections through edges. Okay. So let's explain the inequality. So the chessboard estimate will look strange. It will not be obvious from the start that it will be useful for anything, but then I will give you some non-trivial application of it to show you how it works. So let's fix some number b smaller than l. So l is the size of the torus, as usual. I will fix some another integer b smaller than l, so positive integers. And such that l divided by b is even. Now let's consider a subbox in the torus, lambda b. Lambda b will just be the set 0, b minus 1, to power d, seen as a subset of the torus. Okay, this I see it as a subset of the host TDL. Okay. Then I can write, so let me maybe make a picture for. So that's Arthur Rusty B L, so that's L. And that's B. And that's lambda B. Okay, here we have zero. And then what we can do is we can write TL, because of this assumption that this is an integer, we can write the torus TL of D as a union of translate, disjoint translate of lambda B. So T DL, I can write it as the union over all T which belongs to the torus TD L over B of lambda B plus BT. Okay, I'm just translating by BT, by multiple of B, the box lambda B. I can reconstruct the torus in this way. Now, so now let's say that a function f from omega L to R, let's say that it is lambda B local. If its support is included inside this small box lambda B. If support of f is included in lambda B. Okay. It's a function which is lambda B local. And then what I want to do is, starting from a function, let me again maybe make a picture. I want to start from a function which is lambda B local. So I want to take a function which lives here. So here I want to put function f. Let me write it like that. It will be clear why for in a second. And then I want to construct from this function, I want to construct if you want copies of this function f in each of these cells. Okay. So what I could do is just take the function f and translate it everywhere in each of the cells, but that's not what I want to do because the natural thing in this chapter is not translation, it's reflection. So I want to construct copies of f everywhere in each of the cells by reflection. So I will start by defining f here, by taking the function which is here and reflecting it. Okay, if you want in a picture, it's okay. This has not too much meaning, but it should. I hope it's clear what I mean. You take the function which is defined here. You apply you apply theta, with theta is the reflection going through. I mean, separating these two edges, these two boxes. Okay, and you get a new function which is the reflection of the function, the original function in this box, and you can iterate that. I reflect it here, and then I reflect. Sorry, reflect it here, and you go on like that. And so on and so forth. Okay, and I can define the function, reflection of the function f in each of the boxes. So I can define it for any t in this. So these boxes, they are indexed by this coordinate. So for any, say, so the original is defined here, I want to define it here, so I take a T which index this vertex. So for any T which is in T L over B, we defined F T as, so we start with F, and then we apply some reflection theta 1, and then some reflection theta 2, and so on and so forth, up to some reflection theta K, say. Okay, where all these reflections, so where theta k, theta l is a reflection through the edges connecting the cells. Lambda b plus b tl minus 1 and lambda b plus b tl. So this cell and this cell where t0, which is equal to 0, t1, t2, tk, which is equal to the finality I want, is a nearest neighbor path on the torus on T L over B. Okay, so I'm just written precisely what I was saying here, which is just that I choose some path, say maybe this path here. I choose this path, which goes from this cell to this cell, and then I construct reflection in this way. And obviously, by what I have drawn here, it does not depend on the path you have chosen. Right? It does not depend on the path you have chosen because L over B is even. Otherwise, I could take a path which winds around the torus and arrives here and get some contradiction. Right? So it's here that I'm using the fact that it's even. I mean, it's not only here, but this is certainly one place where I'm using it. Okay, so this defines this copies of the original lambda b local function. And with that, I think I have all I need to state the chessboard estimate. Said everything I need. I think so. Yeah, so just one last thing. So let's say that the measure mu is, say, biperiodic if mu is invariant by translation by B in any coordinate direction. Okay, I want the measure to be invariant if I shift the torus. I mean, if the origin was there and I shift the origin here or there or there, I want the measure to be always the same. Okay, so that's a measure which is biperiodic, and then now I have everything that I need. So let's state theorem 10.8. Chessboard estimate. Chessboard estimate. So let's consider some measure, the probability measure mu on the torus, which is biperiodic and such that mu belongs to is reflection positive with respect to theta for all theta, for all reflections of this type, the satellite type I've used here, all reflection between cells of this partition of the torus. Okay. So I don't know how I've written it. So between neighboring cells of the partition. Then, if you give yourself a family of function, ft, indexed by the cells, okay, which are all lambda b local, So I take here in this picture, I would take 16 functions, which are all which all have their support in this particular cell. Okay. Then we can write we have this inequality. So the inequality looks a bit ugly, but it's I will try to explain what it means. So let's see. So product over all t in t d l over b of f t t under mu. So what do I have here? So I started with this say 16 functions which have all their support here, and then the function which is indexed by this t, in the t which index this cell, I bring it here by a suitable reflection. So that's the function as defined here. So I'm reflecting it and bringing it in this cell. So the function ft has been brought to the corresponding cell by this succession of reflections. Okay. And then I have a function now. In this product, I have a function in each of the cell, a different function in each of the cell of the partition. And I want to compute the expectation value under mu of this product of functions. So I have one function in each cell. And this is smaller than the product over t in t d l over b. So I've taken out if you want the product. And now I have the expected value of the product over s in t d l over b of f t s mu. Looks ugly, right? But I will explain what it means. It means something very natural. Oh, and I forgot something, of course. So this, written like that couldn't be correct, because if I multiply my function by 2 here, I would multiply them by 2 to the power of the volume or something like that. So I need to have something homogeneous. I need to take the power 1 over the size of the torus, the rescaled torus, T d L over B. I hope it's readable. Okay. Now it's homogeneous, so there is a chance that this is true. So what have I done? What is the expression on the left and the expression on the right? So let me try to explain that with a picture again. Let me take a very, very small torus. I mean, I will just take 2 by 2. I mean, this TL over B. And then I have, in this cell, I have a function which is indexed by 0, 0. I have some function f of 0, 0 in this cell. Then here I have the reflection of a function f 1, 1. Okay, it's not really, it's the reflection of this function. Okay, let me write it f 1, 1, 1, 1. Okay, it has been 1, 0. Okay, I had this function f 1, 0 was also lambda bilocal, so it was also living here. But then I move it here. And then I have f 0, 1, which I move to the cell 0, 1. And then I have the function f 1, 1, which I move to the cell 1, 1. Okay? So that's the type of expectation I'm computing on this side. I'm computing the expectation of this particular arrangement of functions. And what I have on the other side is a product over, say, ij, which are just the 0, 0. Okay. I, which is which goes from 0, okay, which belongs to 0, 1, j, which belongs to 0, 1. So this goes through all the four possibilities here. And then I have what? I have the expectation value of something which is very similar, if you look at what is written here. But what I do is that I take always the same function. Instead of having four different functions, I take always the same, the function fij, which I move in the corresponding cell. Ij, 0, 1, f, ij, 1, 1. And then I have to take 1 over the size of the torus, which here is 1 over 4. Okay. Right, so what have I gained by doing by this inequality? Here I have something which is very inhomogeneous. I have a different function in each of the cell. And now what I get on this side is something where I have the same function in each cell, I mean up to reflections, I have the same function in each of the cells, Fij everywhere, same function everywhere. And then I take the expectation of this thing, which is much more homogeneous than what I had here. And then once I've taken the expectation, I take the product over all possible choice for the function which I'm copying everywhere. Right? So that's the content of this set with absolute value. That's the content of this theorem. And you will see that it's extremely useful. So let's prove this theorem. Before, I just want to make a remark, because I will need it later on. I'm stating everything here to simplify the notations. I'm stating everything here with cells which are cubes. Okay, but you could take rectangles and things which have different size in different direction, and everything I'm saying just remains identically true. There is absolutely no changes if I do that. Of course, then you have to define properly what it means to be biperiodic. I mean, and how much I have to shift in each direction depends on the size of the cell. But everything is completely straightforward. So everything extends in a straightforward way to boxes lambda b which are rectangular, okay, parallelepipeds with integer size in each direction. So this I will not do because the notations are simpler if all the directions, if it's a cube, notations are slightly simpler. But that's the only thing. Okay, so it's almost 10, so I suggest that we make the break now, and in 15 minutes we prove this claim.